It's just Sean. I've been. What's the word? Perplexed about the Burning Wheel game system, game mechanic. I've asked people in the past, how does it work? Many have tried but failed to explain. In just a paragraph, how the game works. Like, okay, the rules is the. I want to say the Burning Wheel book, the in its entirety, are rules, except for maybe magic spells. Usually, magic spells are kind of like left alone, separate from the game mechanic, but magic spells tend to make books really huge. Anyway, so Mr. Max here, he's gonna explain Burning Wheel. I notice he's not doing it in just a paragraph. He's gonna take almost half an hour to explain the rules. Wanna say the fight scenes, the combat, whatever. It's pages long in the book, just combat, if I remember right. Anyway, let's hit play.
Hello guys, today is going to be my second foray in my How to Play series, and today I wanted to cover the Burning Wheel. And again, those are not meant to be deep dive, they're not meant to sell you on the game or tell you what the game is about, they're not meant to make you an expert, nor will I try to make you ready to run the game. Those videos are just for if you are to be invited to join a game on short notice, you could watch them and be able to follow along. I will also not cover character creation, as you can just follow the book for that or use a pre-gen character. And this is not a review. I'm not going to comment about the design of the game, nor will I talk about the politics of the author. And maybe I will make a companion video to this one that will be more of a critique.
Was it Luke Crane that made this book? Maybe him and someone else. He got in trouble for something like 10 years ago. Disappeared. The book went out of print. Then the book was back in print. So I don't know. Maybe Luke Crane lives.
More the design discussion. The Burning Wheel is the dice pool system with D6s. The dice give you success, and in a standard test, you have to beat an obstacle defined by the GM. It's just the number of success you need.
Well, I want to say it gets more complicated than that. Especially if you start doing points, adding and subtracting points, bennies, that kind of thing to the pools. Looking for successes. That's, I don't know. I want to say if I've watched anyone play this game online, it's another one of them. It's a role play system. It's a mechanical role play system. So if you follow the mechanics, technically your character is role playing. Not you. Not you. You're just playing a game, but your character is role playing. I mean, was that the focus of this game in the first place, is to get characters to role play? Not the players. The players is just there to roll dice. Anyway, there's one part where the players sit down and discuss the matter before any dice are rolled, because they're setting up a scene. That's where I usually tap out. I'm like, okay, I'm out. I'm done.
Thunder's test, you have to beat an obstacle defined by the GM. It's just the number of success you need.
Anyway, he might be able to explain better. I mean, I'm sure he will. Maybe he can convince me to be more enthusiastic about this. I mean, this is like fourth gen RPG design at its best, I suppose. I can't think of another role-playing game that comes close to Burning Wheel. So beat an obstacle, beat your opponent. The more successes, the better you do. Additional successes on a roll give a bonus on next roll. See, in my games, it's one and done. You roll, you do a skill check, one and done. It doesn't. Then, okay, you did good on that roll, so now later on in the game, you've got this added thing you're holding on to, this bonus thing, whatever, that you can then apply to your net. I don't do that. I'm on a roll, man. I'm on a. No, it's. Don't do that. I don't. Does that happen in real life? Can that be role played? I'm on a roll, man. I'm on a roll. It's each encounter, each situation is its own thing, right? Each one is handled differently. Anyway, let's see. Maybe he'll explain it. So that I'll be like, ah, because this game is hard ass to play. Hard ass. I don't like my role-playing games to be hard.
In versus test, you have to get more success than your opponent. And then you have graduated test, where you don't have an objective per se, but the number of success you obtain determine how well you perform on a task you're trying to do. Then you have link test, and those are for more complex action that will require multiple tests with more than one skill, and those can be done by multiple characters. But the success of one test impact the following test. If the previous test was right on the obstacle, you get no modification. If the previous test had more successes than needed, you get an additional dice on your roll. And if the previous test fail, your test obstacle is a
'Cause you're building on this weird foundation that you're gonna roll a pool of dice. Let's say they're all D6s you're rolling. And then you're gonna look for all the dice that were six, that kind of a thing. Or five. Those would be your successes, right? You're counting all the dice that rolled that number. That's pretty random, right? That's kind of a random thing. Let's say you roll six D6s and you get two successes, right? You roll two sixes. Let's say you do it again and you get four sixes, or you do it again and you get no sixes, and you do it again and you get no sixes, and you do it again and you get one six. So it's like, that's too random. The success rate is too random. And then you're gonna, depending on how you rolled, you're going to then, that's gonna penalize or help you on your next roll. You're hurting sixes, you're hurting successes. I like the old days when people just had to roll a target number or higher. And the target number was the difficulty. Easy peasy. Best design ever thought of by any RPG game designer. Best. Best in the world.
Increased by one. And this plus one die or plus one obstacle is using a mechanic of advantage and disadvantage. If the circumstance of a situation work in your favor, you can gain an extra die and only one dies, and that's if the GM agrees. If the circumstance works against you, your obstacle is raised by one, and this is not limited to one. And you can have both an advantage and some disadvantage on a roll, and they do not cancel out. You add both to the roll. Some tests are they do not cancel
I
out.
don't know.
You add
I don't know what an obstacle is yet. So here you can add a die, I'm guessing, to your roll. A plus one obstacle. What are you doing? What is an obstacle? You're rolling a brick instead of a die? What's going on here? I don't know what that is yet.
bolt to the roll. Some tests are open-ended, which in those cases you can reroll an additional dice for the 6 you roll. So basically the 6 on the dice explode. So advantage, disadvantage.
Exploding dice is one of the worst mechanics I've ever seen for role playing. I mean, it might work for die games, you know, dice rolling games. People that love rolling their dice. I mean, exploding dice? Sure, I get to roll again. Yeah. Those people aren't self-aware. They're not even thinking about role playing in the game. They're just thinking about winning when they're rolling dice like that. It's a dice winning game instead of a role playing game.
The type of test, but how many dice do you roll and what number are you looking for? That is determined by...
Okay, number of dice plus target number. So if it's a dice pool thing, what's the target number for? What is that? Number of dice plus a target number. I don't understand. Help me out.
By the skill, the stat, the attribute you roll. Each skill, stat, or attribute has an exponent, which is basically the rank or the level of the skill. Burning Wheel use a lot of overly complex and pretentious language. I'll save that for the critique. And they also have a shade that can be black, gray, or white. So the exponent of the skill determines how many dice you roll, and the shade determines the number you're looking for on the dice for a success.
Oh, man. So it's not just rolling sixes on dice. You can roll a 4 or a 3 or a 2. Wow. When does the roleplay start? During this mechanic. Before and after this mechanic. Where's the roleplay? That's what I want to know.
Most of your skill are going to be black shade. So you need 4 or more for success. So 4, 5, or 6. If you improve your skill to a skill to a gray shade, trees will also count as success. And on a white shade, the 2 count as success as well. So in a white shade, only the 1 give you no successes. A character can help another character. So, and if you do so, the player will have to lend 1 dice or some.
Does that character have to be standing next to the other character to do that? Or can the party be separated and still be able to do this?
Time 2 dice to an ally that roll a test. And there's a limitation when you can help another character with a skill for if the other character is rolling a skill or a stat test, but you cannot help with a stat to help another skill. So skill can help skill or stat. Stat can help stat, but not skill.
Fatigue. He's trying to avoid the fatigueness here. And this is just helping. I would make this optional, not even use this. Help yourself. There's no helping in role-playing. I mean, there is, but this way? I don't think so. I want to skip ahead to the good parts, but I think if I do that, I'll be totally out of the loop, and I won't know what the heck anything's being talked about, because you have to go step by step through all this stuff.
Kill. And circle can help circle, and resource can help resource. I'll talk about those a little more later. If the exponent of the skill that you're using to help is 4 or less, you grant 1 dice. If it's 5 or more, you can help with 2 dice. And when helping, it's important to distinguish the dice that come from the help, so the character can know if they were actually helpful or not. Then there are...
Some help you were, friend.
The forks, and there's a lot of subsystems in that game. Forks is basically you helping yourself. If you're testing for a skill and you have another skill that could help, this other skill can grant an additional dice for your test, or 2 additional die if you're...
Man, the die pool is just getting bigger and bigger. It's like, these aren't money cheats, are they?
Of the skill.
Well, you just spend your character's money to just buy dice. Pay to win. Is there a rule for that? I'm a rich dude, so I always get to roll 10 dice. What's your problem?
That you're forking is 7 or more. Each skill is linked to a stat. They call that the root. If you not have a skill, but you would need to make a test for it, you roll its root stat, but the obstacle is doubled. So let's talk about those stats, attributes, skill, and other.
Okay, so that sounds like an untrained role of some sort. You're not trained in a skill. There are way so many easier ways to do an untrained skill role than this. Maybe Luke Crane was trying to patent this idea. Maybe that's why he wrote the game this way, so he could patent the thing. More than just copyright, but patent.
Another thing that constitutes a character. A character has 6 stats, which are will, perception, agility, speed, power, and constitution, which the designer insists on calling fort for no good reason.
What's wrong with fort? Instead of constitution. I don't know, fort and constitution are 2 separate things, right? Constitution is like how much, your physicalness, I suppose, like, how much bang up damage you can take. But fort is, I don't know. Americans say forte because they don't know how to pronounce, but fort, I want to say, is the strong point. That would be your character's strong point, which is different from constitution. What else we got? Power? Maybe power, yeah, strength, I guess. Speed. I would call that reflex action or something. Speed. Metabolic rate. Anyone see the new Flash movie yet? I hear it's got some good parts, some bad parts to it.
So will is about the social stuff. Your resilience, your empathy. Perception is pretty much self-explanatory. It's about how acute your senses are. Agility is how nimble you are. Speed is how fast, but also all coordinated. It's like the basis, the root for skill like dancing and stealth. So it does kind of step over agility quite a bit. Power is your strength. It's important for damage. And fort is how tough you are. Then you got attributes, which are derived from stat sometimes. I won't go into the details for that. This is part of the character creation, so it's beyond the scope of this video. The attributes are health. It's how well you can recover from injury, how much you resist pain and fatigue. Reflexes, which is not tested, but determine how often you can act in a fight. Steel, which is basically your moral. And mortal wound, which is also not tested, but represent how much injury you can take before dying. And some characters will have additional attribute that can be something like grief, hatred, greed, or fate. That comes from character creation. It's like elves have
I like those kind of characteristics. Yeah, it's sort of like your personality almost. It's like the thing that drives you, things that drives your character.
Grief, a dwarf have greed, and orcs have hatred. Then you have circles, which are the people you know that could be useful, and resources, because money and wealth is abstracted in this game. The physical tolerance grayscales are your injuries. Injuries come in 6 levels: superficial, light, medium, which they call midi, severe, traumatic, and mortal. I guess another level that is less than superficial injury, which doesn't cause any maluses. But on the scale will be listed where each of those levels starts, and I'm not even going to try to explain how this is calculated because it's very wonky. Each level of wound gives...
Hey, wonky is a term I use, so I kind of know what he's talking about.
A specific penalty. Superficial wounds raise the obstacle for every skill, stat, or attribute test by one. Light wounds remove one dice from your dice pool for test, and midi wounds remove two dice. Severe remove three dice, and traumatics four dice, and those effects are cumulative. So having a-
to me, it's easier to just add negatives to your roll. If you're disabled, if you're injured, if you're dying, just makes it harder for you to succeed. And the results of your die roll are, you know, predictable. You're gonna have critical fails. You're gonna have severe critical fails as you're dying. But taking someone's dice away when they're trying to make a roll, and then and the success things. Ay, ay, ay. It's like, are you rolling for a 4? Are you rolling for a 3? Are you rolling for a 2? You know, that kind of thing. A lot of people have this book, and a lot of those people don't play the game. Who knows? Maybe if I was an RPG collector still, I would have all the books of this. I would have it all on a bookshelf, collecting dust. I used to buy RPGs. I used to be a collector. It was a waste of time, waste of shelf space for books I'll never play. What's the point? You read the book, and you're like, okay, this game's never going to be played. Why do I have it? Maybe sell it to somebody on eBay. I don't know. There's like, why do you have it? What's it for? Most people probably just pirate the PDF if there is one. I'm so sick of people offering me, here's a free PDF. Here's the game. You can have it. No, I don't want it. I'll buy it myself or order the hard copy. I don't like PDFs. I prefer to have hard copy stuff, you know, hardcover. But there's a group of people out there. They just want to, oh, is it, I'll mention a game. The first thing out of the mouth is, oh, can I download that from somewhere? So I have issues with that. I mean, me, I want players to know the system. When we're going to be in a, you know, if we're going to be in a game, I expect the players to know the system. I don't expect them to freaking pirate copies of a book, though. No, they can buy the, if they want to be in the game, they can buy the game, I suppose. Anyway.
A light and a midi wounds remove three dice from your dice pools. The superficial wounds have an exception. Receiving multiple superficial wounds doesn't increase the obstacle beyond +1, but if you get three superficial wounds, it is transformed into a light wound that removes one dice. When you're going to take damage, it's going to be said as a shade and an exponent, like B3, so you fill one of the circle in B3. All those wounds have to be treated and recovered from individually, and I'm not going to go into that here.
Yeah, the injury does seem kind of wonky. What is this? Oh, you write in the skills. I see. I'm used to the skills being listed on the character sheet, and you just put a number next to them.
You can see there's no pre-written skill list on That's your weird. Character sheet.
That's freaking weird.
That's because there is a lot of skills. In the book, it's 55 pages.
55 pages? 40 skills is the most I need. I think 40 is a good number of skills. Across maybe what? 8 pages of, describing the skills. 8 or 9 pages. How many skills does this game have, I wonder?
And each page has between 5 and 12 skills. And those skills can get very specific. Like Beast of Burden Wise. You know about Beast of Burden. Or Prospect.
I would just put Beast of Burden, level 1. And through role play, you can do things that would make sense for a Beast of Burden activity that you're doing. If the skill has a whole paragraph of description about how to use it, and if it becomes a mini game in itself, that's going the wrong direction.
Prospecting, if you want to locate veins of precious metal to be mined, but not mine them, because that's a different skill, that's a mining skill. Something that these games focus a lot about are.
There's a sci-fi game that uses Burning Wheel. I'm curious what kind of sci-fi skills are in that game. What was that? Burning Empires. I think that's what the game is called. It's probably out of print. Samuel G, I think, did a video of that, but he may have deleted his channel. I'll have to look and see if anyone's done a Burning Empires game review on YouTube, because I'm curious how many skills the game has and how different the skills are. Is there a difference between like the electronic skill, a generic electronic skill. If you break that up, you're gonna have circuitry design, you're gonna have wiring, you're gonna have fuse testing, stuff like that. You're gonna have those kinds of skills. Maybe you're not good with a soldering gun, but you're pretty darn good at making the I don't know, the board, I guess, that the circuits then get soldered into. Like, you can make that board. Now I'm curious how Burning Empires works, if it even has that kind of stuff.
The bits, which are believe, instinct, and traits, and each character will have three stated belief, and beliefs are very specific thing. They can be stuff like all magic users are evil and they must be burned, or like I mentioned in the previous video, always do the right thing, not what easy or what is easy or convenient. Or it could be something like everybody deserves a second chance, or maybe might makes right. Instinct are about what a character always or never or sometime do. They will be stated with stuff like I always X or I never X or when X I Y. You're also gonna have three, and they can be stuff like I always hide an extra silver coin in my underwear, or whenever I enter a room, I look for every potential exit, or every morning, I inspect my arms and armor for any sign of wear and tear, or I always keep my distance from a stranger I encounter on the road. Traits also define your character, but instead of just making them up with GM approval, like the believe and instinct, you pick them from a list, and there are three type of traits: character traits, column traits, and die traits. Character traits can be cosmetic or just stuff that doesn't have any direct mechanical impact. If they are cosmetic things, you're not just like somewhat that, you are the epitome of that. If you pick ugly, you're not just like looking like ugly.
Epitome, epitome. I worked for a company once that they made point of sale software. Hang on, let me wait for this guy to drive by. So the company was called Epitome, and people that didn't like the company would say Epitome. Software was the epitome of crap software, like the worst software I've ever seen. Using SQL of all things, good grief. Anyway, it's nice to write down your beliefs and your instincts. Like your character always does such and such, or your character believes in such and such, or your character refuses to ever do such and such. That's all fine and dandy. Why are you writing those things down though? Is it gonna like give you bennies later on? Anyone in the group have? I never wear hand-me-downs. Anyone in the group have that written down? Do a plus one to your roll. That kind of nonsense. I want to know what would be the reason for these things. If you act out of character, do you get dice taken from you when you roll?
I do. You're truly repulsive. You also have character traits that are non-cosmetic, like alcoholic or xenophobic. The column traits are used in a specific circumstance to break a tie or to reroll a skill. Every column trait describes when it can be used. They can also only be used once per session. And die trait gives you bonus die to a skill in certain circumstances. Die trait can be used as often as the circumstances are met. A big part of the burning wheel is Arta. Arta is a form of a metacurrency you can spend to help with tests. In fact, it's three form of metacurrency because
Three.
nothing can be simple. So you have fate, persona, and deeds.
Oh, that's what the FPD is
Arta is
for.
gained through the bits we discussed earlier. Fate is gained by role-playing your belief or instinct and traits. And it's voted on at the end of session. People at the table go, "Oh, I think Marcus should earn a fate point for when he did this."
How about after the game session, you have a pretty remarkable story that was created during the game? Be happy you have that. I would just add money to the game. Just FDP, whatever that is. Forget that nonsense. Just add money to the game. The actual currency that players can use to buy stuff. Spend two to make a roll open-ended or to ignore the effect of a superficial wound. So beliefs, instincts, and traits. You're role-playing your trait? How would you do that? So if you're hideously ugly, that would be the NPC's job to role-play how hideous you look. Because if you're hideous, right? You're a hideous character. It's probably nothing to you. I know this guy. He's hideous looking. His face is burned up. Hair's burned off of his skull, scalp or whatever. He has no hands. Because where he came from, he was a thief. So they cut off both of his hands. And he's a crackhead on top of that. Pain in the ass. Oh, and he's mute. His tongue is missing. So he can't talk. So he acts like it's no big deal. That's just the way it is for him. He's like in his 40s by now, so he's probably used to it. I don't know what country he may have come from. But he's a thief. He's a rotten. What do they say in Skyrim? You rotten something thief. Anyway, he's one of those guys in real life. And lives in the sewers. He's just acting like, Joe Average, I guess, when he's roaming around the town. It's the people he encounters. Those people are responsible for role-playing their character when they see this guy approaching them. And so far, all the NPCs I've seen that have come in contact with the guy are role-playing their characters pretty good. pretty darn good, I must say. But the guy with no hands, he doesn't have to do squat. I mean, he's having a hard time eating food scraps that he finds in dumpsters. You know, he has no hands, so.
You can also gain fate for good roleplay or using the right skill at the right time. Fate is not too rare. A few points can be earned every session. Fate point can be used.
Oh, here's another guy. Another guy in the neighborhood. He has no arms. He has no arms. But he has hands. Okay, so at the end of each shoulder, he has a hand with fingers. But the hands don't move. Fingers don't move. It's just the hands just kind of droop from his shoulders. You know, it's like just veins and skin are what hold the hands to his shoulder. So he might as well not even have those hands. Because when he walks, his hands just kind of flop around. And to him, it's normal. He was born that way. So he's around 30-some. And now when the NPCs see him, they react pretty well, pretty darn cool, I think, for characters never seeing a guy with no arms before. But the guy himself, the player himself, who might be ugly, it might be an ugly thing to have no arms, he seems okay with it, because that's just who he is. He has to have handlers to dress him, feed him, that kind of stuff. Unless he's using his feet to feed himself, who knows. Usually when you have no arms and no hands, your legs are pretty flexible. Is that the right word? Because you're using your legs all the time instead of anything else. So, what's another character that would be hideously ugly in my neighborhood that small children and old ladies look at and go, "What the hell?" You know, their first instinct is to swing a bat at it until it's dead. Who else? I mean, when I was a kid, when I was like 5 or 6, I would see nuns at the grocery store, you know, dressed in their uniforms, the black and white uniforms with the hoods and everything. I'm 5 years old. That's something I hardly ever saw outside of a church or something. And I would point and go, "Look, look." And my mom would go, "It's not polite to point ever." So, I probably only remember that because I never pointed at anyone ever again since. "Look, grown man, look, look." So I was a perfectly good NPC reacting, I suppose, for a 5-year-old kid. Seeing a whole bunch of nuns in the store. I'm like, "What is that?" Like when you're a kid and you see your teacher at the store. "Mrs. So-and-so, what are you doing here? You're supposed to be at school."
To make a role open-ended, or so you can ignore the effect of a superficial wound for a test. Persona is gained by having a character accomplish a personal goal, or by being the warcore.
I would just die. Just let me die. I'll make a new character. Is there ever a game session where the guy says, "Guys, I need a hand here. I'm dying. Can you help me out? Can you help a dying man?" And the players just, they look the other way. They're all at the same table, right? All the other players are just kind of looking away, ignoring him. "I'm dying here. You're going to let me die. Ah, curse. I spit at the brah." And the character, you know, dies. The other players at the table just ignoring this other player whose character is dying. It's like they don't even want to help. I'll remember this. I'll remember what you did to me and my other character. Does that ever happen in Burning Wheel? Just curious.
First of the MVP of the scenario. This is also voted upon by everyone at the table at the end of a session.
Anyway, I'm a huge fan of dying, and apparently that affects this one guy, this one YouTuber. I might do a video about him. He's a YouTuber. Not a YouTuber, exactly. He just has a few random movies on his channel. But he's a crazy, autistic, homosexual who's annoying as hell right now. And he's going after me and anyone else who claims to be a role player. He's not having it. So I'm debating if I should do a video. One of those shout out videos to his channel. Just to point him out. He goes after people on all the things, not just YouTube. It's all the forums, all the RPG stuff out there. He's there. He's there going crazy. Where were we? I forget. Oh, so I'm a big fan of dying in my games. If a character is mortally wounded, so be it. Give me another character sheet. I'll make a new character. But yeah, some people, they want their character to live forever. They don't want their character to ever die. Character death is some sort of racism thing. Like, what? Just because I let my character die, or I want my character to die, or I think I should roleplay a good character's death, a good hero's death. Does that mean that's white people's problems? Does that mean what's the other thing? I'm gatekeeping other people from. I don't understand this whole gatekeeping is a weird. It's a woke ass word to begin with. I asked the AI this morning about, you know, what is gatekeeping. She basically just went copy-pasted stuff off the internet, and guess what? The internet is mostly written by Democrats. Woke-ass Democrats now. So the AI is just getting information from there. So of course the AI is going to say, gatekeeping is horrific, it should never be done in any situation. I was like, what? And then I said, so what is it exactly? What's wrong with the gatekeep thing? And every answer was just copied from Wikipedia, pretty much, what the woke people say gatekeeping is. And I had this discussion, sort of, kind of, this morning about the gatekeep. And my philosophy is it's impossible to gatekeep people. I want my character to die. That doesn't mean I'm telling everyone on the planet Earth that their character should die too. They can do whatever they want with their character. They can live forever if they want. Just because I like my character to die off in a heroic, horrific fashion. I'm not necessarily saying that's what everyone else should do with their character. In a one-shot where survivability is kind of low, especially when you got aliens running around on a ship, but then the crazies say, well, just the fact that you have a YouTube channel and you say stuff on your channel, that's gatekeeping. Ooh, anyways, one day I'm going to do a video about this guy. Why not? It'll be fun.
Personal point are used to add a die to a test or to ignore the one die malus from an injury for a test, which are the same thing. Or if you're mortally wounded, you have to spend a personal point if you don't want to outright die.
Okay, that's good.
The dying and recovery.
So if you don't want to die, you can make a roll. Ah, that's good. That's good. So I was in a game once. My character died. Everyone got mad at me. A guy, your character just died? I'm like, yeah, my character died just now. What? I got hit by I had I got hit by a 21. I only had an 18, like in hit points, pretty much, you know. Hit by 21. Hit 21 damage. Kills most humans in Traveler. So I was dead. I wasn't wearing any. I guess everyone thought I was wearing battle armor. I wasn't wearing battle armor. My character would never wear battle armor. Never been trained. He's not an army dude. His character's not in the army. Not a veteran. None of that. All of a sudden, we're going to have combat in this game, right? And for, I don't know, I was killed instantly. So I don't know how that game session worked or not, because I bet you, I want to say during the combat, some of the players probably weren't role-playing. They were just doing combat game. Oh, good, a combat game breaks out. Oh, good, you have combat in this game session. I'm like, okay. I died at like the first 10 minutes of the game session, so I don't know what happened. You know, the game sessions were like 3 hours long, so I don't know what happened during that game session, because I clicked out. I died. My camera mic gets disconnected from the stream. I'm gone. I'm out. I don't know. My character died. Why should I, as a player, know what's happening in the game still, even though my character's dead? That was upsetting to some people. But then it all worked out again. I just showed up later on in the game. The next game session with a new character. Totally different character than the one I had before. And yeah, they got used to that other character being around, and it was all hunky-dory again.
Recovery mechanics is a bit beyond the scope of this video. Deed points are earned by accomplishing things that are bigger than the character, like stuff that impacts the setting. They can be spent to double the exponent of a skill or an attribute of a stat, or they can be used to...
I don't believe in re-rolling dice ever. I don't believe in that. What are you doing at that point? If you're rolling twice, what are you doing at that point in the game? What's going on there? You're trying to win? Are you trying to win the game?
Re-roll all the dice on a test that failed to grant a success. You can only spend 1 point of fate on a roll. You can spend between 1 and 3 points of persona on a roll. Or one or...
Okay, I get the gist of this now. This looks interesting.
But even the game suggests that to resolve combat, like if the combat is not too significant, just resolve it with a simple opposed roll. But if the fight is more meaningful, they have this procedure when you script your action in volley. You have like 3 volley in a row.
Yeah, I don't know if I can do the scripting thing. You know, before the fight starts, the players all describe what they're doing and what this, you know, what their goals are and not really so much haggling or teamstering, but you're just kind of what is it called? You got someone who's doing the arbitration kind of nonsense. And then everyone rolls to see what happens. It just stops the game. It stops the game when you're doing that. That's why I always want real-time combat. Just like in real life. Point a gun, you shoot somebody. Poof, poof, poof. Go on a TikTok. Go on Twitter and watch any TikTok video where, you know, blacks are in a Starbucks shooting at other blacks. It's fast. The shooting sequence, it's pretty quick. You know, TikTok videos are rather short. To the point. That's how combat should be. Short and to the point. Then the scene progresses from there. Without stopping the game, you know, if you call role playing a game, you don't want to stop it just for doing some die rolls and some damage things. You have all these. Not only are you going this way, you got this going on the side here. It's the Matrix. I'm in the Matrix.
Around, and your reflex exponent determine how many action you have in a round, and you divide up those action evenly or as even.
Everything should be a skill. Everything you do in the game should be a skill. Doesn't matter what skill it is. It's just a skill. So, oh, this is a fighting action, so it's going to be this thing. Oh, it's a magic thing, it's going to be this thing. Ay. This is a bit much.
As you can between those the three volleys, and then for each of those action you pick an action, and those action are stuff like strike, block, block and strike, or block, or great strike, or avoid, or counter strike, or change stance, or feint, disarm, knock and draw if you're using a bow. There's a bunch of them. The action are then solved simultaneously per volley. So all the action of volley one are resolved, and all of the action of volley two, and all of volley three. And if you have more than one action, if one more action is done in the volley, you resolve all the action one of volley one, then all the action two of volley one, then all the action three of volley one, before moving to volley two and do the same, and then volley three. Oh, and at the start of each round, you can vie for position. You can disengage, or you can let your opponent come. If you and your opponent vie for position, you're trying to get in the optimal range of your weapon. So your roll speed, and you can get a bonus for the weapon you're using versus the weapon of your opponent. So you have this chart there, you have to consult. Like if you're using a spear and your opponent is using as a knife, you have plus two dice. If you disengage, you'll test your speed with a bonus die, so plus one die. And you look at the chart for weapon length advantage. And if you win, you cannot act against your opponent, but he cannot act against you either. If you lose or you tie, you're.
So it looks like if both players, both fighters have a knife, there's no advantage, it looks like. If both players have a mace or a sword or a pole arm or a spear or a missile, no advantage. But what's this one here? So one guy has a mace and one guy has a sword. One guy has a sword, one guy has a pole, one guy has a pole arm, one guy. I guess there's no advantage still if this is going on. But if a guy shows up with a missile and he's fighting someone with a knife, he's gonna have a plus 2D advantage, I'm guessing.
In your opponent optimal range. If you let them come at you just don't roll. You let your opponent get into the optimal range or the range you prefer. If you both of you use the same length weapon, that's oftentimes what you're gonna do.
Yikes,
The
what is
fight
that?
action, and I'm not kidding,
What
it
is that?
takes 15 page in the books. With very little art, like there's not even one full page of art. It's very detailed. Like strike.
Okay, skip this part.
If you will. And the range combat have their own chart and table and action that you script in volley. Range on cover and duel of wits, it's only one action per volley. Range combat is they refer to as range and cover. You have action like.
Okay, skip. What is this? A weapon chart?
Yeah, there's quite the procedure there again. So.
Oh, this is the bottom half of the character sheet, maybe.
You know if you hit, like with when you resolve your scripted action. So you think damage is gonna be simple? Of course it's not. At this point, I almost feel like it's a joke, but no, like if you succeed in one of your actions to land a blow on your opponent, so the opponent will declare where he wants to take the blow. So he's gonna say something like, oh,
What? I hit you square in the face. No, technically, that was just a graze on the back of my heel somewhere. What? You bastard.
my legs are open, or my arms are open, or my torso is open. There's four sections that you can take a blow on, like torso, head, legs, and arms. Then you can use your extra success that you scored on the when you roll for your attack, for your strike, or whatever. And with those extra successes, you can move the location of the blow. So if the opponent say, "Oh, my legs were open, so this is where the blow is gonna land," then you can say, "Oh no, I'm gonna use one success and it's gonna land on your chest." So it costs one success to grow from the torso or the arms to somewhere else, and two success to go from the legs to the head or from the heads to the
Says here on my extra die rolls here that I got to your brain. My weapon is in your brain. What do you do?
leg. Then, when you chose a location where to land it, you can do incidental damage with your weapon. Two, you need to.
So far, he's passing all of his sanity rolls, explaining the rules here for this game. Okay, now what is this? Damage continued.
Not quite because of the rounding thing, but. And superb damage is 1.5 time your power plus the power of the weapon. But this time you round down. So now you can know the type of damage that your opponent has to mark on his sheet. So that's where you're gonna say, oh, I'm causing B6 damage. But not quite, actually, because, and I'm not kidding there, the damage calculation and armor reduction takes
Forever.
55 pages in the book.
Well, looks like you're dividing by two also. So that's sounds like the blows are being soft landed, or you're pulling your punches, it looks like.
The one thing I mentioned is like armor can ward off damage, which is to be expected, but it doesn't reduce damage. It cancels it out completely,
Just
or
cancels it
it
out.
let it pass completely. When a blow hit a part of the body that is covered by armor, an armor roll is made. Each type of armor has its
Oh
own
man.
exponent and shape.
I hit you. Oh, I hit your armor. Oh, what kind of armor do you have? Oh, let me. Good grief. I never thought about the combat part of the game rules. I always was suspect about the just the role playing parts of the game. If you know how easy how do they get you to role play your character? Well, it's by points. This is another one of them games. They reward you with points for role playing. I'm
You
still
can roll a
here.
dice, and only if this other dice also come up as one, your armor gets damaged by one dice of that one dice of protection. I think this is gonna be enough for an introduction. This game has a lot of subsystem, and it goes quite deep in the details. I wanted to try to make a how to play video about it because it's so difficult to teach and. It was like a challenge for myself. Also, I'd like to make a video talking about some of the design.
Well, Max did an excellent job, I think, explaining this game in less than 30 minutes. And he looks sane. He still looks sane enough.
Element of the game and some of the flaw and something that I think could have been done better. I don't know if I will do it or when. Putting this presentation together was a lot of work, I'm not gonna lie. I don't know if this is gonna be useful to anyone, but I hope you at least found it interesting. I thank you for watching.
Thank you for making this. I was interested. Now I see more clearly now.